good afternoon. We thank you so much for joining us. We know that there's a lot of virtual events that you're attending, given the pandemic, and so we don't take lightly that you've joined us today. My name is Annica Wayman. I am Associate Dean for Shady Grove Affairs in the College of Natural Mathematical Sciences. And we have also Dr. Bill LaCourse, who is the Dean of the college. So just a few reminders before we get into the discussion. We hope you enjoyed the slideshow that showed a few pictures of the new interdisciplinary life sciences building, ILSB, and that was pre-COVID. But it's a beautiful building that we hope you'll have a chance to visit once campus opens up. This is a live event, but it is being recorded. And so the recording will be available later for folks to watch. And there will be time at the end for participants to ask questions. So feel free to put your questions in the chat as we go along. Also feel free to reconnect with people. I know there's quite a few UMBC alums on here, so you can use the chat for that as well. So we will get started. So thank you, Dean LaCourse, for participating in this spotlight. It's great to have a chance for people to get to know you better. So maybe you can start by just sharing a bit more about your journey to becoming Dean of the College of Natural Mathematical Sciences, since it plays such a large role in the initiatives that you have in the college.
Well, thank you, Annika. It's really exciting to be here. This is an interesting format. You know, I'm on the screen a lot every day, and here we are on our screen again, but this one is particularly important, and I too welcome all the people that are out there watching us today and taking the time out of their busy lives to be here going forward. Now, I would say it's a long story, but we'll try to cut it down a little bit about the journey to become dean. And it really starts, you know, with wanting to have an education and knowing that what it could do for you in the future. I can honestly tell you that I probably didn't even know what a dean was when I was going off to school. I was first generation or so. Not many people in the family had gone to college. And so my journey was all about making all the mistakes you can make. That's one way to learn something along the way. So I first went, you know, there's not a lot of money. You know, so I went to Thames Valley State Technical College. This is a great set of schools that some of it doesn't exist anymore. But John F. Kennedy had said that we need to have technicians to run in industries. Mm-hmm. And they set up these institutions, and one of them was I went to do chemical engineering, mm-hmm. applied technology. So I'm going to go full circle on some of this today. And it was a great education. I can remember, I still have the receipt that I could have two semesters of an education for $400. It's unbelievable that I could see that. And I had, it was a great education at the time. And then I went from there and got real excited about getting a job. And I actually got a job at a place called Stouffer Chemical. And within 24 hours, I quit that job because it was not me. I showed up at that place and I'm like, this is not something I want to do. And so I signed up and I went to, I said, I'm going to go to a 4-year institution. I'm going to be more. And I went to University of Connecticut, mm-hmm. for all of one semester. It's hard to go to school without any money. It's very difficult. And, you know, some of the things I probably did wrong, I never saw an advisor. Mm. Never got any help. No questions along the way. And so at that point, get a job. And I was very fortunate to get a chemical technician job at Pfizer Pharmaceutical in Groton, Connecticut. And I fell in love with analytical chemistry there. I wrote my first paper working out of Pfizer Pharmaceutical way back when. I had a good mentor there who encouraged me to go forward with my education. And so then I said, okay, well, I'll try, see if I can do that. So I went to Connecticut College. You know, Connecticut College really wanted to throw away 30 of my credits out of my 90. So I'd have to go back. I said, this is not going to happen this way. Mm-hmm. So I now went to found another approach, and it was called the Board of State Academic Awards. And they basically gave permission from the state of Connecticut for to use Connecticut and all these titles for Eastern Connecticut University, Connecticut, Connecticut College. And so as long as you met the requirements with still the 120 credits, all the same disciplines, you could take courses at any of these institutions and cobble them together to get a degree. Mm-hmm. And that's what I did. And years later, became Charter Oak College. And that was education now was paid for by Pfizer. And they were very lenient in what they did and allowed me to do it. And I had every intention of going back to Pfizer. But then I went, after when I signed up for graduate school, I went to Northeastern University to study analytical chemistry. My first experience with teaching there just changed my mind of what I wanted to do. Because I was there, the AIDS epidemic was starting to hit, and I was teaching some of the classes there, and some of them were nurses, and chemistry was having many of them fail. And I worked with a professor there, Professor Davies, and he came up with a way of working more in a confidential manner, doing menus on Apple IIe screens. And I learned that it's not always what you teach, it's how you teach it that becomes successful. Mm-hmm. And you can see that these are the types of things that in the end are going to bring me to what I do now. And then off to Iowa State University, studying electric chemistry. Sight unseen, I took that job to be a postdoc, but it was a wonderful experience. And then I came to UMBC, and those are my years here, working my way through the ranks. And at each step along the way, just enjoying the community, enjoying the special place that UMBC is, and at each step, finding opportunities such as being chair to make things better for people and to be dean to have a greater influence and do that. My research has focused on industrial partners all these years, from both in Maryland and across. I like the applied nature of science. But everything I've done is what I'm doing now is a culmination of my life experiences. And that's why I don't want the students that come into our programs to make the mistakes that I did along the way. And that's why I developed education systems for everyone. You know, you admitted to UMBC, we owe you the best education possible, no matter what path you took to get here, what disadvantages you have. And that's why I emphasize professional advising. I emphasize mentorship, which should really be championship. Applied learning experiences, compassion, and fairness. Mm-hmm. And I love what Freeman said, you know, inclusive excellence. Mm-hmm. That's what we're all about. And that's why I enjoy programs like the STEM Build program we have with the NIH, where we're looking to help develop scalable and sustainable interventions so that all students, you know, our motto is 500, not 50, all students mm-hmm. can have scholars education here at UMBC. So what about you? How'd you get to be today as associate dean? You have a really great supervisor.
I'll tell you, I appreciate my supervisor even more now after hearing your story. Hard act to follow, but I'll try and keep mine short as well. So I am from the Philadelphia area. So I did not know about UMBC. I wanted to go into engineering, but my dad knew the fact that I was an African-American woman, that I would really need support, not because of my intellect, but because there were just so few of us in engineering. And so that was what I looked for in a school. But I did not know about this hidden treasure UMBC until President Hrabowski came to speak at my school for a diversity day. And once I heard about UMBC, came down to visit, and introduced to the Marhoff program, it was exactly what I was looking for. So I actually, and you'll see some themes for me as well. So I was in the College of Engineering. I was a mechanical engineering major at UMBC. And so you'll see an interdisciplinary theme that runs through my career. Was a Marhoff and also Mark U. Starr. I had a wonderful time at UMBC. I was also a dance minor. So also great for that as well. I became a member of Delta Sigma Theta, Sorority Incorporated. So I had a really great time at UMBC, but also got a really great education. So again, it's really a hidden treasure that I'm proud to come back and work at. From there, I went to Georgia Tech. I was interested in, you know, using my engineering discipline to better society. So that's the other theme that's always been kind of in my career. And so I went into, that's when I started moving a little bit more into the sciences, doing biophysics, bioengineering with my research. But that close connection to the actual solutions that would better society, I wasn't quite feeling at the time with my research or seeing that pathway there. So I took a path with my PhD to industry. And I went to work for Becton Dickinson, medical device company, making anesthesia products and other medical surgical products. From there, there's this interdisciplinary nature, and I still was seeing this disconnect between what industry was doing that was so directly connected to, you know, putting products in doctors and nurses' hands, but then the research that was really cutting edge and forward thinking and had these innovative solutions that were really going to help better, even more so, solve these healthcare issues. And so that's what caused me to look into science policy, seeing how that bridge could kind of be better, more efficient, bridge that gap between the research and the downstream work that was going on in industry. And so it led me actually to create USAID, US Agency for International Development. And there, worked on funding research, and a lot of it this research was to solve development challenges globally, so water access issues or food insecurity issues, malaria, could be HIV AIDS, all those issues. How could research, but funding the local researchers who really had the context of what was going on in the community, be done and really translate into solutions that could help society, their local society, and even globally. So we did a lot of work trying to figure out that translation. How can we get this research for funding to actually lead to those solutions? We developed a model that we actually published last year of how to evaluate and monitor those things. And so when I saw the translational science degree program that UMBC was launching at the Shady Grove site in Rockville, Maryland, it got me really excited, because for me, this space of translational science, biotech, the ability to have a high impact career where you can help people with their healthcare challenges is really exciting. The other exciting piece was the interdisciplinary nature of the curriculum. And so it really kind of spoke to, you know, those themes that I've always been interested in, and being able to train students for careers in this space is exciting to me. So that's how I landed here, working with you, and have enjoyed being here so far. And being back at UMBC has been a pleasure. So I really appreciated it. And, you know, we don't want to discount the fact that we're in a pandemic right now, and it's certainly affected the college and UMBC as a whole, and also us as individuals. So, you know, we want to probably talk about that, and, you know, because it is such a big part why we're talking like this instead of being on campus. I know for me, it's been certainly challenging. I'm fortunate and blessed that, you know, for the most part, we've been fine. But tired of this virtual space, you know, you don't want to see what's around me beyond this camera. Having the kids at home has been a lot. And also trying to stay hopeful hopeful today for the future, for my children, and also for the students, you know, and trying to work really hard to build a better future for them despite what's happening now. So I thought, you know, curious to know how you're actually coping with the pandemic and everything going on.
Yeah, that's a great question. And I've been thinking about this, and I'll start off with the things I miss and then end up where the positive. And I think we have to stay positive.
Yes.
That's just our nature. And as we go forward, it's things I didn't know I was going to miss so much, like my office.
Yeah.
A lot of people, and I've noticed that with my staff and others, this identity with that office of who you are and what you do. Mm-hmm. Unplanned interactions with people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everything's scheduled now, mm-hmm. but you just don't bump into someone and talk with them. I miss working in the lab with my graduate students, mm-hmm. visiting faculty. You know, modern ways I work is to walk over and see people and talk to them, mm-hmm. Calling a quick meeting, or on Friday afternoons, I'd often just hang around in the office and where the cubicles are or wherever they're, and we would just talk. Mm-hmm. And it's a lot of fun, and just seeing people do this work that they love at UMBC is just, for me, is just satisfying. But in the end, it's like you say, we're not two-dimensional beings, right? We've evolved to interact with a whole person.
Yeah.
You see their body language, you see their face and everything. I teach a class this semester. It's Chem 100, Chemistry for Non-Majors. It's a great bunch of students. They're creative, they're smart and funny. But I know that if I was in person with them, the conversation and the discussions would be a lot richer.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so I miss it. But overall, I think the good part of this is I now appreciate things that I probably took for granted.
Mm-hmm.
Eating out comfortably, right?
To sit down and eat out, yeah.
Shopping, you know, yeah. Walking down the center of campus there, it's always so nice. And seeing UMBC alive, any campus alive, right? Mm-hmm. It's not the same without the students and the faculty and the staff and the energy there. It just feels dormant. So when I return, it's things that we just took for granted, I think I'll cherish. And then on the other hand, I'm an introvert, right? So in some ways, I've been training for this all my life. So whether I like it or not. And I've had the pleasure of eating meals at home to people, my wonderful wife, every day. Mm-hmm. At least from my point of view, it's wonderful. And I've got a little chance to have a glimpse of what retirement might look like. And I don't really want to start any rumors here. I'm not retiring anytime soon because I have a lot of things on my plate I want to do. But I can see that it wouldn't be so bad.
Yeah.
So, even though I have a lot to do here. So thank you for asking.
That's good. That's good. I'm glad to see you're doing well. We need you here. So, and you talked a little bit about this, but how CNMS is adapting to the new learning environment created by the pandemic and how you're creating community within the college. You say that the walking around and having those informal connections, but how are you creating that community because of the pandemic and then also the learning environment?
Yeah, I like this question. You're so good with these questions. I like this question because it gives me an opportunity to really just say how amazing our faculty and staff are.
Mm-hmm.
Right? When COVID hit, it was like a Herculean effort. With no questions and complaints, I watched all of them just lift their classes up to online.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Going from something they knew, the way they've been practiced and experienced, to a whole new way of doing it. And yes, it wasn't perfect at the time, but there was a lot of trying that went on. And then I witnessed them, the faculty and staff, just work overtime and double time. And I know, because you're one of the people who have done this. I watched you, right? To improve their teaching, right? Training and practice and trial and error. And I've seen a lot of patience and tolerance take place. All of this with the hopes of not losing any rigor of the program.
Yeah.
And it was at the expense. It's kind of like when you discussed the first part there. And it's at the expense of your own work-life balance,
mm-hmm,
that faculty and staff have put in to make this. And so I see creative solutions. The flip class, people are trying it. I think there's a lot more of it going on. Multimedia presentation. We all have learned how to use WebEx and Zoom and GoToMeeting and Collaborate and Panopto and Kahoot. And you know what it is out there. This is not an advertisement for anybody. It's just reeling off some names.
Yeah.
And there are some skills that can only be learned through doing. And so the laboratory courses have worked to keep the students safe, but bringing them to campus in rotations going forward. Physics, for instance, they made kits. And they picked up kits and they have devices so they could do a lot of the experiments at home on their kitchen table or wherever it would be.
Mm-hmm.
So I've just seen so much creativity coming out of our faculty and staff and so much compassion and caring to give students this education. The hardest part of all is the community. Building the community online is extremely difficult. And we all know that community, like the Meyerhoff program, it's a great community of people. They work together, they help each other. But we want to try to do that as well. And online, you can do collaborative sessions. You can try to bring people together. But on campus, we've always been trying to build community. So the STEM Live and Learning community, for instance, there are people just love science. Come in, live in the residence halls there. We don't care if you're a nerd. We love you, right?
Yes. That's one of the great points about UMBC.
That's exactly.
It's cool to be a nerd at UMBC.
It's cool to be a nerd, right? And you should see how hard the staff is working to make that really useful. We've also noticed over the years, and this is going to blend in with some of the other questions, the previous questions, is there are unaffiliated people on this campus. They don't have a home. So recently, and something I'm looking forward to, is we built the Learning Collaboratory. And this is a place where some of the smaller unaffiliated groups that are on campus can come and work and get some help. And speaking of a community, Maryland has a growing and vibrant biotechnology industry, which you know all about, right? The Translational Life Science Technology Program, that name is a mouthful, so translational science works for as well.
Yeah.
It was really about seeing this great need in the workforce for biotechnology and opportunity for students to be trained for a really good paying job.
Yes. Right?
And the students, you know, like me, I focused on applied science, right? And this is something you can roll your sleeves up and get working. And the interesting part of this story from its very beginning, that this is a program that was developed from the ground up by the faculty. Mm-hmm. They know what they need to do. But probably the most amazing part of it is we were able to bring together three institutions, UMBC, USG, the University of Shady Grove, and Montgomery College, to develop this program from the ground up. Yeah. And in science, we all know how difficult a three-body problem is, right? Yeah, that's for my science colleagues out there and my students there, right? It's,
yeah,
bringing three things together is extremely difficult.
Yeah.
And we did it, and we made it work. But a lot of the success of this program is on your shoulders, because you've done a wonderful, wonderful job. You've taken an idea, a vision, and it was on paper when you got here, and you breathed life into it. So I'll be forever grateful to you, Annica, for that.
Thank you. Well, it's, as I said before, it's an exciting program. I've really enjoyed standing it up, and I think there's tremendous growth that's still to be had with the program. And just for the audience who may not be familiar with Shady Grove, so Bill mentioned one of the three institutions being the University of Shady Grove, which is a higher educational regional center in Rockville, Maryland. And on this plot of land, this campus, there are 9 universities on that one, in that one area. And so it provides an opportunity for students, 70% which come from Montgomery College, as you mentioned, to get a bachelor's degree after they get their associate's degree and not have to leave Montgomery County. So it's given UMBC an opportunity to expand our reach to students, again, primarily from community colleges, to bring that same great education to the Rockville area. And we are looking to expand in the sciences and engineering a lot on this campus, which USG is also interested in. And so the TLST program, which it's a Bachelor of Science degree, we say Translational Science for short, we'll say TLST for short, or we could say Applied Biotechnology. But the idea is to train students for these critical jobs that are needed in the biotechnology industry, primarily in private sector at various companies like AstraZeneca. A lot of the companies you see now in the COVID-19, developing vaccines and treatments, they had a huge workforce gap before COVID-19, and it's grown significantly even since. And so we have this program, and it's not just to increase the pipeline, but train students in a different way. Mm-hmm. And that's what I also liked about the program. It speaks to my interdisciplinary nature, where, you know, students are not just getting, you know, the biology, biochemistry, they get bioinformatics, they also get engineering classes, so biochemical engineering and biomanufacturing. and so that's exciting that students get all of this out of one degree. And then when we teach the courses, I love that it's really applied learning. So we have a lot of faculty members who are from industry teaching these courses as on a part-time basis. Or we have a lot of guest lecturers from companies come in and really talk about, you know, what bioprocess design and controls really looks like in the field. And then we have a lot of hands-on learning as well. So we have the bioinformatics labs, computer labs. We have, you know, biochemistry labs. Bioprocess, once we get back on campus, we want to do some bioprocess control labs. And so students really get the skills that they need to hit the ground running in the industry. So I think that's two pieces. It's not just increasing the pipeline, but preparing them in a way that's reflective of what skills they need in today's industry. So it's been really exciting to stand up the program and see it grow and see UMBC expand at the Shady Grove campus. Speaking of the other campus, what are your thoughts around more ways to keep these two campuses connected? Because it is one university on two campuses.
It is indeed. And in my mind, I see it as one campus. And when I was formulating this program for Shady Grove, I wanted to have just not a program down there. I really wanted to have an extension of the campus. And that's why, rather than, I put a dean's office down there, right? You are the dean's office, and programs could run underneath you. You could have departments underneath this working at Shady Grove. And so that's the whole point, was to have a place where we can grow all those programs you talked about. And as workforce change needs change, yes, right? We have a place where we can work that out. And although we talked a lot about the TLST program, the professional masters in biotechnology. Yes. So you could come in not only through this two-year pathway and enter into the program, but you could also come in from industry into the biotechnology program, and
yes,
and you could add to it at some point as we go along. And the fact that students don't have to just come from the UCOT, they can come to UMBC for the first 2 years,
yes,
and then transfer. So we're staying close. We hired a tenure-track faculty member in biological sciences with an interest in this transitional life science area. And that person will be supporting the mentoring needs of the TLST program. Mm-hmm. We're also double listing courses between the two campuses. And so we've really seen that with high flex classrooms or with this video sharing, that we can have courses on both campuses working together. And I think a good part of it is that many of the faculty that you have in the program, that you've selected wonderful people, are full-time lecturers. Right. Mm-hmm. They're there. They have ownership of the program, and I've been so impressed with it. Mm-hmm. So in my opinion, what we have to worry about is it's not the distance that really separates. It's our perception of the distance that's there.
Right.
Because you come to our meetings, you're at leadership meeting today. Right. Mm-hmm. We are connected in this. And again, you're interdisciplinary, your background. I think you're just ideally suited for this job in a. And it's just proud to work with you.
Thank you. And I'm glad you brought up the professional master's program too, because it does demonstrate how we're really trying to grow programs down there. And so this graduate program in biotechnology was really around, it was on the Catonsville campus, which we're calling it Catonsville campus instead of main campus at times. And moving it down to the Shady Grove campus because of the growing trends of biotech companies down there. And so I think it shows the expansion and the connection. I mean, this could move back and forth, but that mm-hmm. fluidity that we see along the corridor for the university and mm-hmm. and that there's this continuum of mm-hmm. education. So we have the undergraduate TLST program, and then after students get some work experience and want to build into more of a managerial or technical leadership track, they can come and do this professional master's to get those leadership and technical skills. And so I love how UMBC and the college is thinking about this kind of continuum of education where people can come on and off as they see fit for certain skills or knowledge that they need to gain and move their career forward. And so going to your leadership, and you are a great leader. Again, I'm really happy to work for you. Can you share more about your leadership philosophy and how the college is growing and changing?
So first of all, you don't work for me. We work together on these things. So that's the way this all works, to keep that in mind. I actually didn't know what my leadership is. I've never done any of those tests to see what it is. But
I was wondering myself, I'm like, what's my leadership style? I'm trying to think of it.
And I just came, my thing is basically very simple. Find really good people, mm-hmm. right? People that care, that emphasize principled, ethical people, and empower them to succeed. And that's, and then doing so, give them the responsibility, let them do, just let them free, keep aside, watch over what they're doing, be an advocate for them, mm-hmm. and also, if need be, a shield. Right, because this has to be a relationship built from trust. I try to not ask others to do things that I wouldn't do myself. That's why I still maintain a research group. Mm-hmm. It's beside the fact that I enjoy it tremendously and I love my students and I'm proud of every one of them. And they were empowered to go off and get great jobs and do great things in the world. And why I teach, mm-hmm. because every day I'm making decisions as a leader. And I need to have that full empathy. I have to understand what people are doing and what they're going through to make those decisions.
Mm-hmm.
In the college, we're really about facilitating, right? Facilitating the departments, facilitating research, facilitating undergraduate and graduate education, mm-hmm. facilitating the success of our students, but the success of our staff and the success of our faculty. And that's why the college was only founded in 2005, but my vision was to build it out, to help others. Mm-hmm. And so we have a shared business center. Because I don't think everybody that's hired should be knows how to hire everybody, all the rules and regulations, and they shouldn't have to know how to purchase everything, you know, all the rules and regulations. They know what they want to accomplish, but they should be working with their academic mission and what their duties are there. And we can help them through the difficult times and get things done. We have a professional advising unit. Goes back to the first question. I didn't get any advising. Professional advisors can really help you through those early years. They are, I'm grateful to them. A science education research unit. Every day things change and evolve. We can't be like the past. We can't throw everything out. There are new, more efficient ways of doing things. We need to do about them. And the college is administering shared core facilities on campus. We need to have the tools and equipment for our faculty to succeed. These equipment, you know, are run by graduate students and undergraduates to do research. We don't keep it away from them. We're completely changing how pre-health professional advising to be more inclusive, you know, guiding students from beginning to end. We're proud of the students that go off. You know, we're really proud of our MD, PhD programs, and we're really proud of the students that want to be doctors. And there's no better case than the COVID crisis to know how much we rely on their expertise.
Yeah.
We do a lot of research in the college on education, STEM build. That's all about helping students that tend to be in the middle of the curve. Can we give them a super education with scalable and sustainable structures? NSFI Youth Project is about building community, working with the community colleges and helping with that transfer process so it's seamless for the students going forward. And lately, the faculty, this college has been focusing on diversifying its faculty.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, very good.
UMBC is a highly diverse public institution,
mm-hmm.
right? Just walk on our campus every day, and yeah. It is amazing.
It is.
And it is important for our faculty and staff to reflect our student body. Mm-hmm. It needs to reflect the image of America,
mm-hmm.
right? And so we've had great success with the pre-professorate program. Our campus overall has many programs in place, but what we've been doing is called the pre-professorate. And it's finding people with potential, bringing them in early enough, and having a route to tenure to take place. And we are on our, we were on our path before COVID of doubling the percentage of minority faculty from underrepresented groups in the college. Because
mm-hmm.
we need role models.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We need people for them to see that you're a role model, right? It's just wonderful that people can see that they can do it. I can be like you. I want to be like Annica. Myself too. So then in the meantime, this is something you might want to just say a few words about, is the diversity mentoring team.
Yes. Yeah. And I think you're right that, you know, having those role models, it was great. And, you know, when I was at UMBC, that I had the Mahoff program that provided those role models. I can remember at Georgia Tech, also had peer mentors and a few, but I was in shock in terms of what graduate school entailed. And, you know, my peers that were of the majority groups, they already just had that exposure and that confidence and understanding of, you know, the ups and downs of graduate school, whereas for me, you know, it was a whole new world. And so having a mentor that you can talk to, that understands what you're going through, and that looks like you, is really important. And so, you know, we have through the STEM Build program that's in the college of UMBC wide, that, like you said, is trying to provide those interventions for students that might be in the middle, have the potential and really want to achieve in the sciences, but need some support that they may not get from a broader level. So how can we bring that to all students who are interested in pursuing the sciences? And so along with that, how can we also bring them mentoring support? And so through the STEM Build program, I've started this mentoring program, you know, pulling on the Meyerhoff network in a lot of ways, of those who have gone on to have really wonderful careers in the sciences and engineering, and to come back and give career advice to students to show them that you can make it through, and then to help answer questions that they might have as they're trying to get through their classes. It's been really challenging, and the mentoring program launched this September, so the timing was really good, more important than ever, because students need so much support right now. They're working really hard to stay up on their classes, but they're facing so many challenges outside of class. And so trying to keep them encouraged through this process, you know, through this mentoring program was really important. And we had some really great people, Ernestine Baker, Roland Owens from NIH, Paula Whittington, John Jackson, and Talmisha Richardson. And we're grateful to them for being our first set of mentors.
We are indeed.
For these students. And so we basically have these little small groups that meet once a month and just talk about things like, you know, health and well-being and, you know, how to build science confidence and how you sometimes feel like an imposter in areas. And, you know, how do you balance your science identity and your personal identity, particularly when things like, you know, Black Lives Matter and all the social issues are happening and you may feel a tug. So we try and tackle those issues in our mentoring group. So so it's been great.
Yeah, and this is, you know, this is a great example of your leadership of putting this program together. Maybe you could say a little bit more about your leadership style.
Yes, I had to think about this as well.
It's not an easy,
you know, you just do things and sometimes you're running so much, you don't stand back and reflect on what you're doing. But I think I have the same number one as finding the right people, you know, that are just as passionate about the mission of the program or whatever it is you're trying to do. I think that passion is really what's going to make them the self-starter. And if they don't have all the skills per se, they have the passion to figure it out and learn it. And so hiring the right people from the start is really, really important. And you're right, I've been fortunate to have a really great team put in place now to help with growing the TLST program and the graduate biotech program. And I think the other, another piece is once you have them, to listen to them, you hired them for a reason. And so they are really good and, you know, they have good ideas. And so listening to what their ideas are, listening to their challenges, and like you said, seeing how you can help them work through those things. And a lot of great ideas can come out of it, things that you may not have even thought of. So it's really important to listen and then to empower them, as you mentioned, to achieve those goals and activities that they want to do. So it's been really great. You know, out of it, we've actually been able to, one of our associate assistant director of TLST Laboratories, who really came in and wanted to do trainings. And, you know, out of that, we've actually been able to do a kind of synergies that happened. He really wanted to do some trainings to help people with these hands-on lab skills. An opportunity came for us to train displaced workers who were displaced due to the COVID-19 economic downturn. And so that's an example of, you know, you listen, you empower, and good things can come out of it, where we were able to train 11 people who were out of work due to COVID that now have these new biotech skills to go on and get jobs in the biotech industry. So that's kind of my philosophy so far.
I love it.
So maybe we can, we talked a little bit about the biotech workforce opportunities and the trainings and the degree programs. What about other applied math and science jobs that are needed out there? Are there ideas as to how you're thinking about preparing students for these other jobs that might be in applied mathematics or other applied science areas like physics and such?
Yeah, well, one of the things I do is, we just talked about leadership and empowerment, so a lot of these ideas will generate from the departments and the faculty within them to do it. But I know that they're running out, that there's ideas out there for doing that. For instance, actuarial science is something that the math and stat department, working with economics, is trying to put together. Mm-hmm. Applied math, biostatistics is another area that might be really interested, especially in, you know, a lot of the work that gets done on these, the numbers. We keep hearing all the numbers today about COVID, this and that. Well, that's all about biostatistics. They have to get it out there. And, you know, whether you're applied in the chemistry area, the biology area, these are all important. But what I look at is what's the underpinnings of the programs we're looking at. And that's to have a rich content to what you're trying to accomplish. And a lot of applied learning experiences in, you know, of course, TLST has probably one of the richest applied learning sequences required of them. I think at the end is a one-year required internship.
I forgot to mention that. You're correct.
Yeah.
You can't get more applied than that with the internship.
Program. That's right. But 80%, I think the number is like over 80% of our students do applied learning experience at the undergraduate level. And most of the students that go off and from UMBC go off into graduate school. And the TLST programs, even though they're applied, I think they were made to be as rigorous and to qualify those students to go off to post-secondary, to go to graduate school or professional school, should they desire to go that route. And so in no way is it limiting. It's the empowerment of interdisciplinarity that we're looking for going forward. So all of our programs are really premised on unique and rigorous education. So, and what's our goal? To be, for when a student leaves UMBC, they get their degree and they apply for their job, they're competitive.
Yes. Yes.
Right. That's what we want. We want them, if they want to go to a postgraduate opportunity or seek a job in industry or go to government, mm-hmm. that name UMBC has to mean something. And I think there's a trend now to do more certificates, go to more certifications and smaller bites and opportunities. But for me, USG is the place where our applied science, applied efforts will take place. And you are the person to take those under your wing. So
I'm ready.
I know you are. good people, that's what I said in the first place.
So why don't we shift to research? Can you talk about the importance of fundamental research and how it's continuing during the pandemic? What are the overarching values of basic research?
So fundamental research, and sometimes that's, you know, people see when things are created, it's very easy to it, but fundamental research sometimes is more difficult to understand, but it really is by adding this foundation of knowledge to this, so we gain a deeper understanding of ourselves in the world that we live in, right? And from that understanding, I think the power of science and fundamental research is for us we have the ability to predict. We can look into the future, we can see what's there, and we have some ability to create the future because the foundational knowledge is basically, here are the bricks. You can build a house, or here are the materials to put things together. And from that, right, now we can have if you understand viruses, well, you can get HIV, drugs that contract HIV. You can have people that are working at drugs. There's people on campus right now during the pandemic that are working on new therapies or new drugs that for fighting COVID and these types of coronaviruses that are out there. We have new technologies to clean the environment that take place at UMBC and eliminate societal problems. We should, there's such a wide range of Baker's work. And if you really want to get down to what's important about it, is if the United States is going to be competitive with the rest of the world, it's going to be through fundamental research, taking that research and translating it into applied situations. Right? That's where the translation, you can't live without it. And then that becomes something that's useful. So we are working on curing of diseases, imaging tumors, direct detecting cancer in the early stages. UMBC has a satellite mission. I hope everybody knows that we have a satellite flying around up there that delivers information down. Right? We work on quantum information. We have people that understand the black holes in the middle of galaxies. Like, I'm not visiting one, but it's good that someone knows about it. Right, downtown with the Marine Biotechnology Program in IMET, where they work on sustainable marine environments. People are, the oceans are being fished out. They're working on ways to raise fish in tanks in the basement of buildings so we could feed the world. Wow. So this work is all continuing, and the faculty are coming in, they're working with social distancing, they're having masks on. It's important to have the work to go forward, but it's important because it also represents a lot of careers that are taking place. So yeah, the work continues wholeheartedly. Research is a big part of it, because what makes a lot of our undergraduates really successful and our graduate is they have first-class scientists and researchers working on world-class problems of critical significance in all arenas. And so we don't have great undergrad. It's important for that to be here, to have the type of education that UMBC produces.
Yeah. I see we're running a little bit short on time, but maybe you can just say a few words about the ILSB building and how it's facilitating interdisciplinary research.
Yeah, interdisciplinary research is something that you know and love, right?
Yes.
And I'm going to make the premise that all research is interdisciplinary. It's often people that are not, right? So the idea is the ILSB building, the Interdisciplinary Life Science Building, was really put together in such a way that there's no departmental ownership.
Mm-hmm.
People come there to work on problems of great significance that will solve that problem, right? And you need people from the molecular biologist, and you need people from policy, you know, from whatever area to converge on a problem to solve it. So that's the interdisciplinary nature for it. And so it's administered by the college, but all three colleges have faculty members that are in there. And if you're an animal researcher, you will be in that building. That's your ticket to get in. It is a place of high activity. It maybe probably wasn't meant for a COVID era, because it has a lot of group learning ability in there.
Yes.
And it is a masterpiece. And
it's beautiful.
And I expect, and I'd love to give tours when people come here. And we're also creating courses of interdisciplinary, because we have to start beginning. So for instance, Sci 101L, 5 or 6 projects, 2 weeks apiece. All of them in different disciplines, so that we can show the students the connectivity of science and not separate them by what building you're in.
Right.
So we have a lot of emphasis on that.
Yeah, it's a beautiful building. And you're right, just the way it's designed, is it's spaces that just call out collaboration, even the way the labs mm-hmm. are set up. I love that corridor in the back that just mm-hmm. runs along all the labs to really, you know, just emphasize that we're all here to collaborate. And, you know, it's about solving a problem.
That's right.
Challenge. It's solving a problem that, you know, really requires mm-hmm. various disciplines to come together. So I'm going to ask one more question, and then we're going to pivot to the questions from the live chat, and some people also sent questions in advance. So given all that you've said, a lot of exciting things going on in the college. And I love how you're just full of new ideas and you take ventures to be innovative all the time within the college. So given that, what do you want alumni to know about their engagement with CNMS and how they can support?
Well, first and foremost, I am so proud of the alumni, all the students that I've ever had, the ones that I see. I get to know so many of them as with a faculty member, as a chair, and now as a dean, and I see all the great things that people are doing out there. I'm very proud of you out there. And I have students that are listening. At least they said they're on the list. And I want to thank them personally for letting me be their mentor and let me enter into their lives and being a part of it. Being a mentor is a huge commitment. And I want to thank all the alums out there and the parents and friends that serve as mentors and students to the university. And I'd be remiss if I didn't just thank you from the bottom of my heart for the support, the financial support that many of you give. But it doesn't have to be financial that you give. Time is important. And right now, time is precious. And spreading the vision of what UMBC is. We are a unique place.
It is.
We try. And your support is just critical to our success in whatever way you give it to us. And all these programs we talk about, from STEM and Liminal Communities, I didn't talk about the CNMS scholars, right? That's where we looked and combed through the records for people that came in that didn't have the greatest high school records, but then you find them in their third years and they're in physics and they've got 4.0s.
Mm.
We find them, we look for them, and it's really focused on women, so they don't get that feeling like you had, that you're all in a room and everybody's around you.
Mm-hmm.
We get them support, we bring them into a community and call them CNMS scholars. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to help people, but those programs run on the financial support of people that donate to the college. And we know that money's important, is precious, and it's hard to come by. So we steward that money and use it as efficiently and effectively as possible.
Mm-hmm. That's great. That's great. And I like how you emphasize that it's not just the financial support, but other ways, you know, ideas and, you know, engagement, mentoring.
That's right. All those things.
Internships, everything. It's just stay connected, you know.
Stay connected with us. That's exactly right. You know, and I'd love to hear from you. And when we get back on campus, ready to give you a tour.
Yeah. And that the money's being stewarded so well. That's the other piece that I think is.
Well, I'm pretty cheap. You know that. I have to have a good return on investment.
Yeah. We're scientists.
We're scientists.
Every penny. So why don't we go, there's a couple questions live in the chat. One is an alum of CNMS, Keisha Parker, who graduated 2000 in biological sciences, who asked, are any of these industry companies partnering with the programs? So she knows UMBC's Career Center works closely with CNMS. The companies today participate along with many more. So connecting with other companies, what would you recommend for her to do in terms of having, if she has a company that's interested in partnering with the program?
Definitely contact, if you're interested in CNMS, you can contact me directly through the process. I know Caroline Baker from Career Services works with corporate relations as well. She's really good at her job, and so is Sintachi, the whole crew. Mm-hmm. And they can also, at Shady Grove, they can come through Dr. Annica Wayman, and she will treat them extremely well. So we are anxious to have relationships. Again, emphasizing the fact that we are in this, but we don't work alone. We build communities. And we need to know, and industry knows what the problems are. They know what the difficulties are. We're hoping that we can work with you from a research angle or from developing the workforce that you need. So we need to hear from you.
Yes, yes. And just to echo that, I mean, we, in just the 2 years of the TLST program existence, we've had students who have interned at Kite Pharma, AstraZeneca, American Gene Technologies, others, the ABL, there's a ton of companies, and it's not just the internships, but the engagement that they put in to be guest speakers. We probably have, just in the short 2 years, about 20 or so companies with the TLST program alone. So between the Career Center and Retriever Connect, which is the new platform UMBC is launching to connect people, I think you're right, there's a lot of opportunities.
I think it's important to know that a lot of students don't really know what the jobs are out there with the degree they have.
Right, right. Right, exactly. And that's what I'm finding too. Students, they know what they want to do when they get out with their degree, but they're not sure how to match that to the major or how it connects to the classes. So that's where it's great for our alumni to come in. Another alumni, Palomi Benjiri, hopefully I'm saying your name correctly, but from hearing your experience as a student and knowing, this is to you, Bill, and knowing how your college has adjusted in the pandemic, what advice do you have for prospective or incoming students in CNMS?
Trust us. We got you back. And I'm going to say we have had so many meetings. Every meeting is about caring to give you the best experience possible. Yes. And we know that it may not be perfect, but everybody is suffering through that. But UMBC cares. Every individual, we have no better leader than, Freeman Grubowski.
Yes.
He sets the tone, and we have a great provost and the entire staff. And I see the faculty working hard to give you a rigorous education. Even if it's a part of it, maybe online, we're going to try our darndest to have as many courses on campus as possible.
Yes.
And when you get here, don't isolate yourself. You know, come talk to get the advice from professional advising, listen to it, you know, join, get into communities. We'd love to have you here. And my goal is to have every student that comes in treated like a scholar, treated like a professional, and graduate and have that life that they dream of.
Mm-hmm. And just to quickly add on to that, you know, I have the perspective of being a student and now being faculty. And so seeing it on the other side, it even more so emphasizes how UMBC, you know, across the board, the faculty, the staff, the administrators really do put students first, and whatever they can do to help students and you know, develop processes that are supporting students more than it did before. It's always striving to see how we can put help students along in their academic and career journey. So I couldn't agree more. So we have a couple questions that were sent in as well. I love this question. How can we bridge the gap between scientists and society?
Well, the gap is really about communication, right? And how people talk and what they say and then what they hear. It's interesting too, because we did run some workshops that were put on by AAAS about how to train scientists on how to talk with society. We have some great things going on. Like we have a science communications person that works with CNMS there. And she knows how to write stories up and puts the information out there as well. At the heart of it all, tell a good story, tell the truth, mm-hmm. right? That's important. Don't overemphasize about what you're saying there. And so it's a matter of getting people to talk at the level which people can understand.
Yeah.
I have great faith in them. In the American public and the people out there, there's a collective knowledge and understanding of what's right and what's wrong, and we just have to say it, tell them what it, you know, bring it to them in a way that's isn't ivory tower speech.
Yes, yeah, this question definitely gets to my interdisciplinary nature and. Mm-hmm. What was so fascinating about my work at USAID is it wasn't just about the science. You had to think about culture, language, geographic, you know, location, and how that overlays with the scientific results. And so I think that there definitely is a lot to say about bridging science and society and to make sure that we really get the optimal solutions out there to help advance advance our work, advance our societies, advance our world. And I think another great example of this is Kizmikia Corbett, who is an alum of UMBC and the college, and her amazing work with the Moderna vaccine, and had a, you know, biological science degree, but also a sociology degree. And so she understood that bridging that needs to happen between science and society, and look at the amazing work she's doing now to advance that degree that she had, both degrees, the liberal arts degree and the science degree from UMBC. So it's such a fascinating world when you bring the two things together, and much more better things come out from it.
Well, we are a liberal arts university, right? We are a liberal arts university, and you know, I know we have a reputation in STEM, but we believe in the whole person, right? Mm-hmm. Every part of them is educated, and they have to have that culture and that perspective to understand and appreciate everything, the world around them and the people around them, and appreciate the differences as well as the similarities.
Yes. Yeah. Some of the other questions we've tackled, you know, we talked about mentorship, which was one of the questions about types of beneficial mentorship. Also about what UMBC is doing outside of the Meyerhoff program to keep students in the science major. And so we talked about STEM Build and CNMS Scholars. And then let's see, trying to keep mindful of time and see how to lump some of the questions together, get them all answered as well. And then we have, I guess, the two questions that we could probably piece together as our last question. And by no means let this be your last engagement with the college, but perhaps our last question for this time is, you know, what are you most excited about looking at next year? And what's the future of the department research and undergraduate programs look like in 30 seconds?
I strongly desire to be back on campus to see everyone and welcome them to UMBC and do the best. The college has continued to grow. And for the benefit of its students, its undergraduates, graduates, staff, and faculty, We want to build a reputation at UMBC that alumni and parents and students can be proud of. That's the goal of the college. So we will grow research and our reputation. We will grow on our innovation of teaching, and we'll do it in such a way that our faculty and staff maintain a work-life balance. That's great. What I hope for.
Good, good. That's wonderful. Anything, any final thoughts before we wrap up? Sounded like those were some great final thoughts right there.
I just thank you for everybody that's listening today. Thank you for the support. If you've ever, you know, in any way that you ever have it, you've given to us, I can't thank you enough for having interest in being a part of UMBC in any way. And I deeply appreciate it and care.
Yes, absolutely. And on that note, UMBC Acts Giving Day is coming up February 24th and 25th. So that's next week. A 36-hour, I believe, giving campaign. Mm-hmm. So if you are moved to give more, if you're able to, there is a chance for you to give during UMBC's Giving Day. So stay tuned on that. But more importantly, check out the Retriever Connect networking platform, because that's really what we want to do, is just make sure that you stay connected to your Retriever family. And we are really grateful, as Bill said, that you tuned in today. I should fail to mention that another great piece of me going to UMBC was I met my husband, who will be 20 years married this year. And so we certainly do give back to UMBC because of all that's given us. And so hopefully you'll feel moved to give for UMBC Giving Day. So thank you so much for joining us, and have a great rest of your day. Thanks, Bill.